Moore. And then Kenny Lewis, he's coming on up. He's already excited. Hey, hey. I hope I look that good at 73. I really do. He's my inspiration right there.
Happy birthday.
One anniversary, and I see half of them here. The other half is home making breakfast and lunch, right, Betty?
Probably.
Yeah, that's what I was thinking. Well, Leonard and Betty, happy anniversary. Stand up. I know you still stand up. I hope I'm still alive in 62 years. If I can make it that far. All right, thanks, guys.
Good morning, everybody. We're so happy you're here. It may be dreary outside, but the presence of the Lord is warm and cozy in this place. Let's stand and welcome each other this morning. The Lord's grace this morning.
Amen.
I'll tell you, I had a bed to sleep in and a roof over my head. I have plenty to eat. I have clothes to wear. But if I didn't have any of that, His grace would be enough. And I hope that you see His grace as enough in your life this morning. Let's sing together.
Thank you.
Good morning, Zion Hill.
Good morning. Wow. Choir's awake. Good. I don't know about you guys, but the choir is awake. Well, daylight savings time. I don't like it. At least not right now. Maybe later. But I don't like it right now because I woke up with the sinuses at 1:30, and it went from 1:30 to 3 real quick. And it seemed to take very long. And then I had to make a decision. Do I take one of those little pills so I can sleep, or do I not be able to wake up in the morning, or, you know, or do I just tough through it, you know, and hope that I can fall asleep? I ended up taking one of those little sinus pills and had a hard time getting up this morning, and so that was my decision, but at least I got some sleep. You know, time is one of those things we're never satisfied with. If you talk to somebody who's younger, they want time to pass by more quickly a lot of times. You know, they're ready to grow up. They're ready to move on. They're ready to get on with life. Usually when you're younger, you always want to be the next thing. Well, I'm 13, I want to be 15. I'm 15, I want to be 16. I'm 16, I want to be 18. I'm 18, I want to be 20 or 21. And it seems like we're always pushing time forward. And then as we get older, we're saying, whoa, horsey, you know, because it seems like that it keeps going faster than we want it to, and we want to be 20 again and 30 again and 40 again, and so we just keep wanting it to slow down. So we're always wanting it to speed up or slow down, and then as men, we even try to manipulate it, like we can somehow manipulate time. But you know what? Yesterday, you had 24 hours. Guess what you have today? You really didn't save anything. Except maybe a little bit of daylight in the evening. But even that, the sun is going to come up and go down just like it would have the day before. You just manipulated the clock a little bit is all you did. But you didn't change God's time. You didn't change the time of the earth. You didn't change God's timetable. Listen, I'm one of those people who believe when the author of Hebrews says it's appointed unto man once to die, that you have an appointment. I don't know that it to be true, but I believe what the authors of Hebrews is saying is that your appointment time has already been made, and God knows when it is. You don't know when it is, because you don't want to know your appointment date with the Lord, do you? It'd kind of be nerve-wracking if they said you were up to bat tomorrow morning or something. You know, you'd kind of be like, oh man, you know. And so you don't want to maybe know that, but we all have one. We all have an appointment where we will leave this world and we will enter we will stand before a holy God. And at that point, what will we claim? What will we say about our life? Because you see, life is passing by so quickly. When you're younger, it doesn't seem that way. It seems slow. And when you're older, it seems too quick. But it's passing by at the same rate. But it is passing by, and there will come a day when it's over. Our time is up, and we have to stand before God. And at that point, what will we have to say about our life? Will we be able to claim the blood of Jesus Christ to cover all of our sins? You know, the Bible says that when God looks at us, he wants to see righteousness. He wants to see holiness. Jesus said, be perfect as I am perfect. Well, I don't know about you, how many perfect people out there today? Amen. Yeah, not many, right? No perfect people out there today. That's why we need the righteousness of the Lord. You know, an interesting thing, in Chinese uses characters instead of letters, right? In Chinese, the word for righteousness is two characters, one on top of the other. The one on top is a lamb. The one on the bottom is a person. And isn't that what righteousness is? It's the Lamb of God covering us, covering all our sins. So when God looks at us, he sees not our sins, but he sees the blood of his Son, Jesus Christ. Listen, you have the opportunity today to make sure when your appointment arrives that you're ready, for it. I can't tell you when it will be, but I can tell you it's coming. And when it comes, you can be ready. And you don't have to worry about saving time anymore, because whenever it comes, you are ready for it to be here. Amen? Good to have you here today. If you're a visitor with us, hope you'll take time to fill out a guest card. It should be right there in front of you. Also in front of you will be a prayer guide and an Annie Armstrong offering. We'll talk about that a little later on. But I hope you'll take time to fill out that guest card so we can get to know a little bit about you and your family, and also be able to let you know a little bit more about us. God bless you today. Would you stand with me? Let's pray and let's continue to worship together. Father, we're so thankful, Father, that although the days are evil, not meaning that they're all bad, but meaning that, Father, they're short. And that, Father, when a moment passes, we can't ever get that moment back. That's why we need to take advantage, Lord, of every opportunity that you give us. Father, there's someone in this room today who has the opportunity today to receive Jesus as their personal Lord and Savior. I don't know when that opportunity might arrive again, and I don't know if it might arrive again before the date when they would enter into eternity. But Father, I pray that they take advantage of this moment today. Others of us, Father, we know the Lord, and we have a moment in time today to worship Him, to gain the right perspective, to leave our problems, our burdens, our issues at the door, and to, Father, enter into Your presence. So, Father, we need to take advantage of that moment. And then, Father, it is a rainy and dreary day, Father, but we need to take advantage of this day, Lord, and we need to make the most of it, because we don't know, this might be the last day we have. And Lord, we're grateful for a little bit more daylight to take advantage of that day. But Father, Lord, I just pray that each day when we wake up in the morning, we'll thank the Lord for this a new day, a new opportunity to love and serve Him. And we'll never take for granted the days that we have, the health that we have, the strength that we have, the opportunities that He gives us. And each day we'll count our many blessings, name them one by one, and realize just what the Lord has done for each one of us. Father, we give You this hour. We pray and ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. As the Lord was laying on my heart what He wanted us to lift up to Him this morning, the word grace just stuck with me and our need for that grace. And I love the words to this psalm because when I sit down and when I think about, you know, I've been on this planet for almost 43 years. And when I think about it, my sins are great. I've had a lot of time to do some sinning. And I've racked some up. And I'm sure if you were to take the time to sit down and start thinking, you think the same thing. But I praise the Lord that His grace is greater than my sin. I don't have to sit and dwell on my sins of the past. I don't have to worry about the sin that may be coming down the pike if I focus on the Lord and allowing the Holy Spirit to work in my life and concentrate on becoming more like Him. He'll take care of the rest. He'll take care of the rest. So today, don't focus on your sin. Focus on God's grace and on becoming more like Jesus. And you'll find sin becomes less and less of an issue in your life as His grace grows greater and greater. Let's sing together this morning. there's one thing I know about grace, it's that I need it. I need it. I need a whole lot of it. And I love the words to this song because I find sometimes I'll be at the end of my day and I'll think, well, Lord, you know, I came pretty close to leaving you out of that one. You know, to just try and just do it all on my own, just stroll right on through my day and not really think about, you know, what the Lord's plans for that day might have been, or what he might have had me say to that person I met, you know, going along the course of my day. And he reminds me that I don't just need him every day. I need him every hour. I need his grace every single hour. So as we sing the words to this song, I want you to think about the week you have ahead of you. And don't think about it with dread, but think about each hour and how God could work in your life right in the middle of that hour. Cry out to him. Tell him you need him. He knows you do, but there's something blessed about telling him, because when you tell him that, that's when he really starts to work. Let's sing together.
I need.
Amen. That's Kevin Ezell. He's the president of our North American Mission Board. Kevin's a good guy and has done a lot in his time there. And so he's the leader of the organization that we support through the Annie Armstrong Easter Offering, which all the money stays in Canada and the United States in this general area as we seek to reach people for the gospel of Jesus Christ through church planting and other methods and means. And so our goal as a church is $1,200. You'll see there's envelopes right in front of you. You can give that way, or you could just put in the line, four line of your check, Annie Armstrong, or Annie, or something of the such, or AA, I guess. We'll figure it out. And we would love to get that on the mission field. Remember what he said there, every dollar goes to missionaries. We're able to do that because of the support that our church gives regularly to the cooperative program. And so all the special offerings go directly to the mission field. And so it's not like those other agencies like the Red Cross and others where just a portion of your giving goes to the people who really need it because they have to cover their overhead and their advertising and all those other things. Every time you give to the Annie Armstrong, Lottie Moon, or other Southern Baptist offering, 100% of it goes. It's in the bylaws. 100% of it has to go to the missionaries on the field. They can't use it for anything else. And so that's always good to know. You always can feel good giving to missions offering when you know 100% of it is going to lead people to Jesus Christ. So I encourage you to give as the Lord lays on your heart. Take those envelopes home, pray over them, and just give what the Lord would have you give. It may be a dollar, maybe $100, maybe $1,000. It's what the Lord tells you to give is what's important. And together as a church, we'll give sacrificially for His kingdom. Our men are coming at this time, and as they come, I'd like to remind you of another way you can give is when you go to Walmart or Kroger or Food City or wherever you go. If you'll look for some candy, we need candy for Easter eggs. And if you'll leave that in the kitchen area, we're going to stuff eggs with candy for our egg hunt celebration on March the 31st. And then also, we need candy for Zawadi bags. And you can put some hard candy in the Zawadi bags, and that'll go to and fill in those bags and be sent to Africa. So just two ways you can give. Also, when you're at the grocery store, if you want to pick up a thing of spaghetti noodles or pasta, or you want to pick up a thing of peanut butter, you can place it in the Cross Ministry box downstairs. And that will go to Cross to help feed people here in the Seymour, greater Seymour area. Just the ways that you can practically give. Doesn't take a lot of money or a lot of time, but it's a great way to give to others who are in need. Let's go to the Lord in prayer at this time. Brother Logan, would you ask God's blessings today, brother? Thank you.
Children's Church, be released. Surgery.
Thursday.
Everything go good, I guess? Good. Good deal.
Everything went well, just pray now that he's back home.
But shooting we have gets too much longer. I mean, it's just getting the point of it. I mean, you just gotta call it like we see it. So. Yeah, remember Tim, he's got some stuff going on, but I know God's gonna be with him, he's gonna be fine. So just continue remembering him in prayer. So it's that load we gotta carry, Tim's what it is. You know. Amen. Praise God for that.
Remember Kenny's stepdad, Mike. He's having bypass surgery tomorrow. And thank you, everybody, for praying for his dad. He had his surgery this past week, and he's home and doing really good. And I'd also like to just say how thankful I am for the youth that are back there in that sound room. You know, they're faithful, and they're young, but they're willing to serve the Lord, and that says a lot.
Amen. Youth is what's going to keep us going when we're gone. It's going to be the youth that's going to be here that's going to be taking our place. So we need to lift them up and keep them involved and, you know, give them what they need to keep them here with us. Pray for them and watch over them, because that's what's going to keep us going when we're gone. So we have others. Dorothy and her travels going to New York. Godspeed be with her to bring her back with us safely.
There was a home burned down up next to Pearl Valley, like, and a lady got burned up in it. Mm-hmm. My brother Truman told me who it was, but I don't remember who he said, but there's another name.
Remember that family. And those who are injured in that. Just remember the whole situation. Have others?
Pray for me and my schoolwork. Miranda knows I'm in my room right now. It is hard. And I should find out sometimes whether I'm in the nursing program or not. So if it's the Lord's will, hopefully I'll get in. If it's not, then so be it.
Let the Lord's will be done. And continue to lift her up in your prayer. She needs it. So. Godspeed be done. Others.
Pray for our missions, whether it be here in the States or internationally, that our hearts are prepared, as well as those that we're not touched, that their hearts are prepared to hear us.
Remember our mission team. Remember other missions as well. And then when they go out, that they'll have the words to speak, and God will open doors for them, and lives will be saved. Have others.
Maybe
the loss and
grandfather.
And so that means that I'm sure he's saved. And I'm just pray that God will just be with him no matter what. Just touch his heart in ways it's never been touched before. So. Any more? More prayer requests? Praise? Remember Rhonda? She's going away the other day. Keep her in your prayers. Which one? Tabs? Autumn?
Autumn's still in Oklahoma looking for her next assignment. She's tired of Oklahoma, so she wants something different.
Tabs is home. And remember Autumn, she's in Oklahoma, so she's gone a lot. Remember Autumn? Remember our college of career? Some are here with us today, and some are not. So I know some have to travel back and forth to school, so remember them. Remember Sam from Alaska? Samantha in your prayers. Chad, Danny, Matthew. Remember Chad, Danny, and Matthew. Amanda's faithful in praying for them each week. Others. I praise God for this week and getting me here safely and watching over me. He don't have to, but he gets me there and back every day. And so I praise God for that. Others? Any other prayer requests? Any other praise? If not, Cliff, would you lead us, please?
Time of prayer. God bless you today. Time of worship. Love that song. I'm so glad the blood will never lose its power. Amen. I'm glad it's not up to me, but it's up to Jesus and what he's done for us. And we still daily need him and rely upon him, his strength, his power, his word. Speaking of God's word today, if you'll turn to Judges chapter 6, we're back to the book of Judges. As we were going through that, we took a break last week in order to do a pre-revival message encouraging us in a way, giving us a tool in our toolbox with which to share with people the life-changing truth of Jesus Christ. This material is sponsored by the North American Mission Board, which we give through the Annie Armstrong Easter offering, but it's called The Three Circles. And I have booklets. There's still plenty in the back if you did not get one, or if you want another one, or lost yours, or want to share it with a friend. It tells you how to do the three circles and how to draw that out on a napkin or a piece of paper and share someone the life-changing truth of the gospel of Jesus Christ, just simply using this drawing and illustration and a few words describing it. So this will help you, be another way which you could share Christ with others. It's free, available to you today. Back in the back, looks like this, says life on the front. But we want to get back to the book of Judges, a book that tells us, you know, the theme of the book of Judges is basically that every man did what was right in his own eyes. And shows us what's the result of that. When people turn their eyes, turn their mind, their hearts from God, and decide to launch out on their own. And when man believes that he has the answers, when he believes that he can go forth without God, what is the resulting consequences? It definitely becomes a dog-eat-dog world, as they say. And we see that in the book of Judges, how mean-spirited and how rebellious and the lengths to which man would go. But we also, at the same time, see God's great grace and deliverance. How God, even though he will allow us to go the direction we want to go, which to depart from him, and to follow our own devices and live with the resulting consequence. God will never leave us wholly and fully alone. He is still there and within grasp of we're within grasp of his grace. We just simply need to come to him, turn to him, and respond to him, call out to him, and he will send to us a deliverer. He will send to us a way. God promised there will always be a way out from your not necessarily that your circumstance might change, but that your heart might change. Because as we'll find out throughout the book of Judges, God is a lot more interested in changing your heart than he is in changing your circumstances. God is working on you in order to make you what he desires you to be. And that's what we'll find true of Gideon today. But first, I'd like to talk about James Garfield, not the cat, amen? James Garfield was actually the 20th president of the United States. But before that, he was the president of a small college in Ohio named Hiram College, I believe is how you pronounce it. While there, he once fielded a complaint from a father of a student. The father was complaining that his son's coursework was too hard. He said, "This is way too much work for the degree for which my son is getting. Could you make it any easier?" To which Garfield responded, "I suppose I could make it easier, but I'm reminded when God makes an oak tree, it takes him 100 years, but it only takes him 3 months to make a squash. Which one do you want your son to be?" And so Garfield didn't believe in making coursework easier. Amen. He thought if you worked hard, you learned something and you could become something. In Scripture, God often reminds us of the similar thing, that he is interested in changing us from the inside more than he is in changing our circumstances on the outside. You see, God will allow the circumstances in your life to bring change within your heart. Because he needs you to change from within. He needs to transform you from the inside in order to use you. God, in Judges chapter 6, had chosen a man named Gideon. We talked 2 weeks ago about how Gideon was an unlikely hero. He was not what you would expect. But he was called by God to deliver Israel from the hands of the Midianites. But God needed to do a work inside of Gideon. He needed to be transformed into a person that God could use. Listen, friends, God doesn't just use any old person. He will choose any old person. He'll call any old person. He'll call you just as you are, but he won't leave you there. If you're going to be used by God, there's going to have to be a work done inside of you. In other words, God must do a work in you before he does a work through you. You've got to allow God to do a work in you before he can do a work through you to others. When we first met Gideon, he was not in the house. He was under the house. Amen. He was hiding out. He was hiding out in the wine press, threshing grain in order to hide it from the Midianites. He was living in the shadows. He was unwilling to take a stand and unable to see himself how God saw him. You remember how God saw him? The Lord showed up and said, "You mighty man of valor." And Gideon said, "What? Who? Who are you talking to?" Because Gideon couldn't see himself as that. He was in hiding. He was afraid. But once God gets finished with Gideon, we'll see a man transformed. He'll be transformed from a weakling to a warrior, from hiding in a wine press to standing on the mountaintop. From a coward, Gideon will become a champion for the Lord. God wants to do the same, I believe, in your life and in my life. He wants to transform us, the Bible says, by the renewing of our minds, so that we may prove what is the good and perfect and acceptable will of God. God wants to transform you so you can be a victor over life instead of victim of life. Amen? God wants to transform you, and that begins in your time of private worship. But it doesn't just extend to your private worship, it extends into your public witness. It starts on the inside, see, in your private time. It starts on the inward parts, but it works its way out through God's transforming power. Amen? But it's got to start here. It's got to start here. It doesn't start out there. You know, a lot of people are waiting on something in order to be used by God. Well, if my circumstances will line up, I'll be used by God. No, no, no. You got it backwards. God wants to do work in here before he allows you to do work out there. A lot of people say, well, if God will use me out there, then I'll allow him to work in here. No, 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 no. You got it backwards. God wants to do work in here, and then he'll use you out there. Amen? And so we'll see that play out here in Gideon, how his altar of private worship will extend to his battlefield of public witness. Let's begin with the altar of private worship in Judges 6, verse 17 through 24. In Judges 6, verse 17 through 24, and he, Gideon, said unto him, the angel of the Lord, if now I have found grace in thy sight, then show me a sign that thou talkest with me. Depart not hence, I pray thee, until I come unto thee and bring forth my present or my offering, and set it before thee. And he said, I will tarry until thou come again. And Gideon went in and made ready a kid or a young goat, and unleavened cakes of an ephah of flour, the flesh he put in a basket, and he put the broth in a pot and brought it out unto him under the oak and presented it. And the angel of God said unto him, take the flesh and the unleavened cakes and lay them upon this rock and pour out the broth. And Gideon did so. Then the angel of the Lord put forth the end of the staff that was in his hand and touched the flesh and the unleavened cakes, and there rose up fire out of the rock and consumed the flesh and the unleavened cakes. Then the angel of the Lord departed out of his sight. And when Gideon perceived that he was an angel of the Lord, Gideon said, alas, O Lord God, for because I have seen an angel of the Lord face to face. And the Lord said unto him, peace be unto thee, fear not, thou shalt not die. Then Gideon built an altar there unto the Lord and called it Jehovah Shalom. Unto this day, it is yet in Orpah of the Bezerites. Gideon began at the altar of private worship. He recognized who was before him, the angel of the Lord. And he said, wait on me a minute. I've got to go and I've got to make an offering that's acceptable. And when I come back and worship, then will you wait for me while I get it ready and prepare it so I could come back and worship. And so Gideon began the process of transformation at the altar of private worship. And what did he experience there? If you're following along in your bulletin, the bullet points there. The first thing Gideon experienced in his altar of private worship was he experienced acceptance. He experienced acceptance. You know, Billy Graham is known famously for, who just passed away a week or so ago. He was known famously at the end of his crusades to often sing, Just As I Am. What a great old song. What a reminder that God accepts us just as we are. But my friend, he loves you too much to leave you there. God didn't save you just as you are so you could remain the same. God wants to change you from the inside out. He wants to transform you into something new. The Bible says anyone who is found in Christ is a new creation. Behold, the old has passed away. Behold, all things have become new. So God accepts you just as you are, but he's not going to leave you there. And we see the desire Gideon has for the Lord's acceptance in verse 17 when he says, if now I found favor in your sight. Gideon wants to be accepted by the Lord. Is the Lord willing to find Gideon in favor in his sight? In other words, Gideon wants to know beyond a shadow of a doubt that it's the Lord that he's talking to and it's the Lord who's called him. Amen? He don't want to go out and do anything for anybody until he knows that he's accepted by the Lord. And so the same is true for me and you today. Friends, a journey of 1,000 miles begins with the first step. Then the first step for us, if we're to be transformed inside from the inside out, is to be accepted by God. And to be accepted by God, you first must accept his son, Jesus Christ. Amen? That is God's plan. That is God's avenue for acceptance, is through Jesus Christ. When you choose by faith to place your belief and trust in Jesus Christ and his son, the Bible says you begin that process of transformation. It's by grace you've been saved. It's not something that you do on your own. It's not something you accomplish. It's a gift of God. Have you received the gift of God's son, Jesus Christ, this morning? That's the avenue for acceptance. Have you been accepted into his kingdom? Have you been accepted into his family? If you have received Jesus Christ by faith, you have. If you claim the blood of Jesus Christ and what he did for you at the cross, then you are part of God's family. You are part of God's kingdom. But if not, then you're not accepted by the Lord this morning. And if you haven't been, can I ask you simply, would you do it today? Would you ask God today? All you got to do is ask for him. Jesus said this. He said, "Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If any man will open the door and receive me, I will dine with him and he with me." And friends, all you have to do today to receive Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior is be willing to open the door of your life to Jesus Christ, and he will come in. You've got to be willing to receive him. That's it. What do you do with a gift but receive it? Jesus has bought and paid for it. You must receive it. If you'll accept Jesus Christ as the one true Son of God who died on the cross and rose again for your sins, then God will accept you. Amen? And that's what Gideon wanted, is God's acceptance. He said, "If I found favor in your sight." And the same is true for us. We want to know that God accepts us, that he is the one who calls us, that he is the one who shows us, that he's the one who saves us. My friend, God accepts you through the person of his Son, Jesus Christ. That is God's choice. All may come to Jesus Christ. All may come to the altar of God. All may be found in favor in his sight. But they must come through the avenue for which God selected. They must enter in through the door. They must enter in through the gate. Jesus said any other person's a thief who tries to enter in anyway but besides the gate. The gate of acceptance is Jesus Christ. Would you come to him today? Would you open the door of your life to Jesus Christ? It all begins at the altar of private worship. Why is it private? Because it can't be done to you or for you. Amen? It can't be done to you. You can't go to a monk, an imam, a pope, a cardinal, a priest, or a pastor and them do it to you. Amen? It's private worship. Nobody's going to do this to you. Also, nobody's going to do it for you. Your grandma, your grandpa, your mom, your dad, your best friend, your Uncle Joey, or your cousin Vito. Amen? Nobody's going to do it for you. It must come from the altar of private worship. You yourself must make a personal decision to open the door to Jesus Christ. Jesus is knocking. Will you come? Jesus is at the door. Will you open it? It can't be done to you or for you. But if you want to be accepted by God, you must first accept his Son, Jesus Christ. Amen? You can do that this morning. But not only does Gideon get acceptance, he finds assurance. He experiences assurance. "I will be with you," the Lord says. We see Gideon's desire for assurance in his plea. "Show me a sign," he says. "If it's you, show me a sign." Have you ever asked God to do that? Have you ever asked God to show you a sign? "God, I want to see you. I want to know you're here. Would you show me a sign?" The Bible says that God still reveals himself today. He reveals himself and his will for our lives in one of these ways. It's usually through the Word of God, through prayer, through circumstances, or through the church. So it's a good thing you're here this morning. Amen? Who knows? God could speak today. He has promised to lead us, guide us, and direct us. He's told us he can be found if we'll seek him with our whole heart. Are you seeking God's will for your life today? Are you seeking God? Do you want to know what his will for your life today? Well, how do I know, preacher, that what I think is God is saying is really God? Well, I can tell you one way. God never contradicts his word. Amen? God has never and will never contradict his revealed word. And so what you hear God saying has got to line up with the Bible. Amen? Another way God tells us is that he encourages us to seek a multitude of counselors. He says, ask around, ask people what they think. You receive a multitude of wise counsel, so watch who you ask, amen? Well, those who are wise. And then it says, weigh your decisions through prayer. Seek God through prayer in making a decision, and he will guide you. His word is a lamp unto our feet and a light unto our path. The thing we must remember, though, is that God is patient and long-suffering. His timing is not always our timing. Listen, friends, God's never early and he's never late. He's right on time. But always it's not according to your plan, your timing, your calendar that God chooses to work. He's patient and long-suffering. Also, I find it interesting that God did not respond to Gideon and give him the assurance that he longed for until Gideon brought an offering to the Lord. Do you find that interesting? He brought a sacrifice to the Lord before the Lord gave him the assurance he asked. You see, we've been raised in a culture. Our whole culture wants something for nothing. Amen? Do you not believe that? Do you not look around and see that? Everybody wants something for nothing. Give me something and cost me nothing. That's what they want. That's what people want. But and Christians have been bought into the same thing. We've been taught to expect God to work on our behalf without any cost because he's a God of love. He's just expected to work on our behalf without it costing us anything. I have a hard time finding that in the Bible. Not that I don't want it to be true. I want God to love me so much he'll just give me anything I want anytime I want it. But I just don't find that in the Bible. You show me where it is in the Bible and I'll go with it. You know what instead I find in the Bible? In the law, Deuteronomy 16:16 says, "No one is to appear before the Lord empty-handed." That's what I find in the Bible. And so Gideon asked the angel of the Lord to wait until he returns with a sacrifice. And it's only then that he receives the assurance of God's presence that he requires. Listen, friends, following Jesus costs. Count the cost. Salvation is free, but following Jesus will cost you. But it'll lead you to tremendous blessings. But you're not going to get it for nothing. Salvation's free, but you're not going to get everything you want in life for nothing. God expects obedience. God expects you to operate in faith. God expects sacrifice. God expects worship. God's not in the business of giving something for nothing. And so Gideon says, wait here a minute. I recognize who you are, and I haven't prepared my heart, and I haven't got, let me go get my sacrifice, bring it back, prepare it. Will you wait here for me? And the angel of the Lord said yes. And so he experienced acceptance. He experienced assurance. But notice finally he experienced aptitude. He experienced the I can do it mentality. What does the Lord give to Gideon in response? What does it say there? Peace. Peace. He's called Jehovah Shalom. The Lord is our peace. The peace of knowing that Gideon is accepted by God. The peace of knowing that Gideon is in the presence of God. The peace of knowing that with God with us, we can do anything. Gideon, if I'm with you, you can do it all. So he builds an altar to the Lord right there on the spot and names it Jehovah Shalom. The Lord is my peace. Do you know God's peace today in your life? What is God's peace? Is it the cessation of violence? Does it mean we're not ever going to experience stress or strain? No, that's not the peace of God. It's the peace of knowing who you are. It's the peace of knowing who you really are. It's the peace of knowing whose you are, that you belong to the Lord. And it's the peace of knowing God's presence, that he will help you through any circumstance, not just to survive, but to thrive. I loved in our Sunday school lesson today when it talked about what God did with the waters. God said he took those bitter waters and they threw in the branch and it turned them sweet. Listen, friends, God didn't promise to take away all your troubles. He promised to turn them sweet. Amen? God didn't promise to take away all your heartaches, all your troubles, and all your sickness. He says, I'll turn it sweet. I'll work all things for the good of those who love me and were called according to my purpose. He'll turn it sweet. And notice where the Israelites ended up. Once he turned it sweet, they ended up at Elim. 12 wells. Wonderful, wonderful place. Where's Elim? One day you'll get there. One day you'll get to heaven, the city of God. You'll experience God's lasting peace. But until then, he'll take the troubled waters, the bitter waters, and he'll make them sweet. And that's what he did for Gideon. Gideon, we're in a world of hurt here, but I can make it sweeter. I can make it sweeter. You can experience my acceptance. You can experience my assurance that I'll be with you, and you can experience my aptitude. You can do it. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Amen? That's what Gideon asked for. He received it at the altar of private worship. And he had to receive that first before he could go on to the public battlefield that he was called to wage. But listen, God doesn't stop there at the altar of private worship. He doesn't just want undercover Christians. He doesn't want people who just meditate and read their Bible and pray all the time but don't do anything with it when they get out into the world. He wants us to go. How many times in the Bible do you read this word, two letters, G-O, go? Go! Go! God leads people, God saves people, God changes people, God transforms people so they'll go out and do something, right? And so Gideon's private altar of worship led to a public display of worship, led to a public altar, led to a public battlefield, a public witness. Let's look at verse 25 through 32 real quickly. And it came to pass the same night. God didn't waste no time, did he? It came to pass the same night that the Lord said unto him, take thy father's young bullock, even the second bullock, of 7 years old, and throw down the altar of Baal that thy father hath, and cut down the grove that is by it, and build an altar unto the Lord thy God upon top of this rock in the ordered place, and take the second bullock, and offer a burnt sacrifice with the wood of the grove which thou shalt cut down. Then Gideon took 10 men of his servants and did as the Lord had said unto him, and so it was, because he feared his father's household and the men of the city, that he could not do it by day, that he did it by night. And when the men of the city arose early in the morning, behold, the altar of Baal was cast down, and the grove was cut down that was by it, and the second bullock was offered upon the altar that was built. And they said to one another, who hath done this thing? And when they inquired and asked, they said, Gideon, the son of Joash, hath done this thing. Then the men of the city said unto Joash, bring out thy son that he may die, because he hath cast down the altar of Baal, and because he hath cut down the grove that was by it. And Joash said unto all that stood against him, will you plead for Baal? Will you save him? He that will plead for him, let him be put to death while it's yet morning. For if he be a god, let him plead for himself, because one hath cast down his altar. Therefore on that day he called him Zerubbabel, saying, let Baal plead against him, because he hath thrown down his altar. So at the altar of private worship, we experience acceptance, assurance, and aptitude. But it leads us to the altar of public witness, where we go public before the Lord, where we come out of the closet, Christian, amen, where we stop hiding, where we get out from under the house, and we get out into the public, where we get out from the wine press, and we go to the mountaintop, and we shout from the mountaintop, I am the Lord's. It leads to something, our transformation. It works on the inside, but it works its way out. And what did Gideon experience? Two things. First of all, he experienced submission. Immediately, God asked Gideon to do something. He asked him to remove something from his life that was keeping him from being 100% God's. His father, you see, had built an altar to a false god, Baal, and right next to it, he built a fertility pole. Both were an abomination to the Lord. God challenged Gideon, come away from those old ways and come out anew. God challenges us to come out from the world and to turn to him. Listen, friends, God wants all or nothing. He wants 100%. He wants first place in your life, not just at church, not just on Sundays. He wants every day. He wants everything. God will not share you with anybody. And so he wanted Gideon to come out from the idols that had been placed over his life and fully embrace Jehovah God. So he said, go out and tear those things down and instead place an altar to the Lord. Listen, that's what God calls us to do today, you and me. He calls us to find the idols. He calls us to find the falseness in our life, the sin in our life, the things that are abomination to the Lord. He says, destroy them and instead place an altar to the Lord. The way of victory is through submission to God's will and God's way. This morning, if we want God to do a work in and through us, we must ask ourselves, do we have an idol in our life? Do we have something we put ahead of God, or is God first place in every area of our lives? Is there anything that offends God in our life? If so, destroy it. Tear it down. Burn it up. And instead place an altar to the Lord thy God. Serve God and him only. Come out from this world. Leave the old ways behind you. Repent and turn and embrace his plan for your life, and victory will follow. No repentance, no victory. No repentance, no victory. Jesus arrived on the scene. His first words were these: repent, for the kingdom of God is at hand. No repentance, no kingdom. No kingdom. Today, people think they're going to come to God's kingdom without repentance. My friend, they're destined for a devil's hell because no repentance, no kingdom. No repentance, no victory. We must experience submission. Gideon, come out from your old father's ways. Come out from the idols and false gods. Come out from the things that offend me. And give me 100% and I'll show you victory. Friends, do you want victory in your life? You better come out. You better come out. God's not going to share. God's not going to share the glory with all your false gods. God's not going to share the glory with all your sin that offends him. He will not do a work through you until he has your heart, until he's done a work in you. Where your treasure is, there will your heart be also. You better turn it all over to him if you want victory in your lives. Amen? Gideon experienced submission. So I'm going to give it all. 100%. Now, mind you, Gideon's a lot like us. He did it at night. He was a little afraid. Didn't want to get caught. Wasn't so sure of this tearing down the altars and burning it and stuff. Not so sure that it's going to go well. But you know what? Gideon didn't only experience submission, he experienced success. Look what happened. When Gideon took his stand, he experienced success. He didn't think he would. How do you know that, preacher? Because he did it at night. If he was that confident, he would have done it right in the middle of the day. But he wasn't confident yet. He's not so sure, but he did it. Listen, sometimes we get all caught up with feeling bad because we do the right thing, but we kind of feel bad about doing the right thing, or we do this and that, and we kind of feel, well, I should feel more on fire for God, even though, listen, just do the right thing, right? You may not like it, you may not want to, you may be scared about it, you may be uncertain, just do it. Gideon said, I'm going to do it at night. Is that okay, Lord? Just do it. Do what I told you to do. And he did it. And notice what happened here. His willingness to put himself out there and do what needed to be done in the name of the Lord didn't just impact him, it impacted the entire community. It began a movement that would lead to eventually the people accepting his leadership over their life and him becoming the deliverer and the judge that God meant for him to be. God was doing a work in him and it was working its way out. Now Gideon was perceived differently in the eyes of the people. See, before, they didn't even know his name. All they knew was, who was that? Who's that kid? I think it's the Gideon. Is it Gideon? The son of Joash. That's it. It's like nobody even knew who this guy was. He's out in hiding. Nobody cares. He's the forgotten son of Joash. But now he's known as what? The man who took down a god and lived to tell about it. He didn't take down another man. He took down a god. Woo! Glory. I can follow this guy. He took down Baal. Baal didn't do anything to him. He's the man who took down a god. His willingness to repent of his sins and receive God's grace and forgiveness, as well as his acceptance of God's call and his willingness to obey, now put him in position of greatness. Not just in his own eyes. Now he knows that he can succeed because of what he did. But other people's eyes. Now other people looked at him as great. Why? Because he took a stand. Did what was right. How about you, friends? Are you willing to take a stand? In your home, in your school, in your work, in your community, even if you're only one, will you take a stand so that God can position you for greatness? Will your obedience inspire others to follow Jesus? Or do you just like fitting in with everybody else? I always laugh when people say, I want to be cool, I want to be different. And then they go out and act like a heathen like everybody else. Is that your way of being different? You look like everybody else to me. How about going out and living for the Lord? I don't see that going on much in our schools today. I don't see that going on much at the university campus. I don't see that going on much in the workplace. Somebody taking a stand for the Lord, thy God. You want to be different? You want to swim against the stream? You want to stand out? How about live for Jesus? I guarantee you, you'll stand out like a sore thumb. And everybody will notice. And listen, just like Elijah and the prophets, that he said, I'm the only one left, God, and they're going to kill me too. God said, I actually got about 7,000. Wow. And if you'll do this, this, and this, they'll all come out and we'll be all right. What are you saying, preacher? There's other people out there. They just need to be inspired. They just need to be inspired. There's other people out there in the church. There's other people in the community. There's other people where you work. There's other people in your school. They love Jesus too, but they're afraid. They're hiding. They need somebody to inspire them. They need somebody to say, rally the troops. They need somebody to say, we're going to live for Jesus. Who's with me? That's what Gideon did. He just rallied the troops. And we're yet to see here in a couple weeks. We don't have time today to see what God does through Gideon. He'll do the same through you. Stop being like everybody else. Go out and rally the troops for Jesus. Go out and inspire somebody through your obedience. Go out and follow Jesus. I guarantee you, you'll be few and far between the people of this world today if you'll truly go out and follow Jesus. You know, they had this book, now they got a TV show called Living Biblically. I just wish some Christians would do it. Maybe we need to watch the show. Maybe we need to read the book. And of course, they want to, you know, do all the laws and stuff like that. But I just wish we'd live like Jesus. What would that be? What would that do if we just did that for a year? Just take a year of your life. Just 1 year. I'm going to ask, what would Jesus have me do? And I'm going to do it, whatever it is. Boy, what would that do? Well, let me finish with a man named Telemachus. You heard of him? Cool name. Logan, one of your kids, Telemachus. He's a 4th century Christian. We call him a monk. He lived in a remote village. He spent most of his day tending his garden and spending time with God in prayer. One day, he discerned the voice of God telling him to go to Rome. So he obeyed. He set out on foot. It took him weeks to get there. He's weary and worn down when he arrived in the city. He arrived at a time of a great festival, and everybody was heading to the Colosseum. So he followed the bustling crowds to the Grand Colosseum, and he saw the gladiators as they stood before the emperor, and they said, "We who are about to die salute you." But it was just as they began that he realized what they were going to do. They were going to fight to the death for the entertainment of the people. He immediately began to cry out, "In the name of Jesus Christ, stop!" As the games began, he pushed his way through the crowd. He climbed the wall. He dropped to the floor of the arena. He rushed forward toward the gladiators, shouting, "In the name of Christ, stop!" The crowds at first thought he was part of the show. They began to laugh at him. But then when they realized he wasn't part of the show, they began to become angry because he was holding up the fight that they'd come there to watch. As he pleaded with each gladiator to stop fighting, one of them took his sword and plunged it deep into the small man. He immediately fell to the ground, but as he lay dying, his only words were to continue to stay, "In the name of Christ, stop." Then all at once, something very strange happened. The crowd grew silent, and one by one, they all made their way, without talking, out of the Colosseum. Do you know that would be the last day there would be a battle to the death of gladiators fought in the Roman Colosseum. Never again in that great stadium would men kill other men for the entertainment of the crowd. All because one man, one voice, one life was willing to be obedient to the Lord Jesus Christ. What about you? Will you be the one? The one man, the one woman, the one voice, the one life that God will use to do something great? Will you be the next Telemachus who follows your Jesus all the way, even if it costs you your death? People, you may not have known him when I began telling his story, but you'll never forget him from this day forward. One man, one voice, one life. What will you do for Jesus today? Let's pray together. Father, in Jesus' name, we long to experience your acceptance. Father, the acceptance of God is through Jesus Christ, his Son. Lord, you accept anyone who will come to you by faith this morning, just where they are. We don't have to do anything to earn your acceptance. We simply pray and by faith receive what Jesus Christ did for us when he gave his life and sacrificed his all on the cross. And his blood was shed, his perfect atoning blood, so that we might be saved. He was raised from the dead so that we might know that God, he was God, who he said he was, and that God, the Jehovah God, was pleased with his sacrifice. And so that we know that it worked. And now by faith, if there's a person in this room who's yet to receive Jesus, they can now pray a simple prayer. Just saying, Jesus, I know I'm a sinner. I believe in you. I believe you died on the cross for my sins and rose again. Right now, as best I know how, I ask you to forgive me of my sins. And I'm asking you today, by faith, to be my Lord and Savior. Friends, as you pray that prayer, then you're accepted by God. But he's calling you to come out, to be different. He's calling you to come forth, to be something new. He's promised his presence through the altar of private worship. He will accept you, he will assure you, and he'll give you what you need to get the job done. And then one day, maybe tomorrow, maybe next week, maybe next year, maybe 10 years from now, just like Telemachus, he's going to call you out into public witness. You may not be run through with a sword by a gladiator, but God's going to call you out to publicly proclaim your faith in him in some way. In fact, he may be doing that this morning. You may be here today and you've never been baptized. Listen, friends, baptism's a public profession of faith. Baptism is no different than what Telemachus did that day. He publicly proclaimed his faith in Jesus Christ. Would you do that today? Would you come and declare yourself for baptism? Would you make your faith public? What will you sacrifice for your Lord today? Will you be the one in your workplace, in your school, in your community? This altar's open. It's your opportunity to hear from God and to respond how he leads you today. Father, into your hands we commit this time of invitation. We ask you to work and move in our hearts as only you can, so that we might be an unlikely hero like Gideon. Lord, some of us probably are a little afraid and uncertain. Lord, that doesn't make us any different from Gideon. We just simply need to make a decision to follow Jesus and to do what's right. And he will turn the bitter waters sweet. Lord, we ask this today in the most precious name of Jesus, who went all the way to the cross for us and never gave up, whose blood will never lose its power. Amen. Would you stand with me, if you will? We're going to sing a song of invitation. It's going to be number 309. You sing with us, you come. The altar's open. I'll be glad to receive you. Others will be glad to pray. Will you come as we sing this morning?
From God.
Amen. today. Listen, the altar of private worship is always open.
And it all starts there. It's got to begin with our decision to follow Jesus and our devotion to Him. God will never take you further in public than you're willing to go in private. If you're one way in private, you'll never be another way in public. It'll eventually come out. There is no two-faced characters with God. It's the opposite is true. Some people think I'll put on a show in public and I'll be any way I want to in private, but that's not the way it works with God. You must first begin at the altar of private worship. As you begin to get to know God and He gets to pour into you, He will begin that process of transformation. And you won't even have to work at it coming out. It'll just naturally work its way out as God begins to tell you what to do. You'll receive a prompting, like Gideon, to tear down the altar of Baal and the Asherah pole. Or it may be like Telemachus, to take a journey to Rome not knowing why. But God will eventually press into you a burden that you can't help but go and to do and to share. And at that time, you'll be obedient, and God will give you success. Now, I'm not one of those TV preachers who tell you success always looks good. Telemachus paid for success, right? But if he would have stayed on his little plot of land, doing his gardening and praying, we wouldn't know who he was. And the gladiator games would have continued. But because he was obedient, his last act of devotion stopped those horrible games. His name is etched into the annals of Christian history. And while that sword must have hurt as it was going in just a moment, he was in the presence of Jesus, who was saying, "Well done, well done! Good job, you did it." And I believe somewhere, somehow, God showed him the result of his actions and what happened after he died, so that he would know his place in God's plan. You have a place in God's plan. God wants to use you. Just in their everyday life, you can be an everyday missionary for the Lord Jesus Christ. A couple of things to mention today. I hope you'll take a bulletin home. Mine has no cover, amen? Or actually it does, you just can't see it. It's invisible ink. International trip meeting tonight from 5 to 6. We have about 8 to 10 maybe going on international trip this year. We'll be meeting to discuss where God has us and what He has us doing this year. We do need those eggs, the candy for the eggs. We have some eggs. Flo's got some eggs. We just mainly need candy, hard candy, you know, candy that won't melt. If you put it out there for high, you'd be surprised how fast chocolate can melt. So a harder candy would be better, I guess, or candy that won't melt quickly. You never know what kind of weather it's going to be on March the 31st. Could be cold, and it could be hot, it could be rain. You just never know. And so, but bring that candy, whatever you bring, we'll stuff in those eggs. Just make sure it'll fit in the eggs. And yeah, don't bring us a whole candy bar, amen. And so, and it's got to fit in the eggs, all right? And I'm sure the youth is leading out this year. We'll have a stuffing party or something. We'll get it done. The spring revival meetings are coming up with Brother Tom Melzoni. We got special music. We encourage you to be here Saturday night, March 24th at 7 o'clock. Sunday morning, same times. And then Sunday night, March 25th at 7 o'clock. So three Spirit-filled, impactful services. I hope you'll come, bring somebody with you. We're having a special service during Holy Week. This is the week after, the week leading up to the first week of April. Or the 1st of April, that Thursday, March 29th at 7 o'clock, we'll celebrate the Lord's Supper together, focus on the death of Jesus in a Maundy Thursday service. We've mentioned our Zawadi bags, also needing hard candy, suckers, Smarties, etc. You could pick up both for the egg hunt and the Zawadi bags, one bag each or whatever at the same time. So that's a good, easy to remember. And for those of you volunteering in VBS, there's a clinic, an association-wide clinic on March 19th. From 7 to 9 o'clock at Beach Springs Baptist Church. The annual event is free. You get some goodies. You get trained on, get to see the new material, which is game day this year. And so if you're planning on volunteering for BBS, we'll take a van. If